Hello friends, how are we doing? I have not done a video like this in a long time where I see whether I've read books based on a certain category. Have I read books? Do I read books? Have I ever read books? Who knows? I haven't done this in a long time, and something that I have done for the past couple years is go back on my most anticipated releases videos and see whether I've read them and like, were they my most anticipated? Because I keep track on my spreadsheet, like whether I've read releases, but not every book that's on my releases spreadsheet goes into my most anticipated releases video. So we're gonna do another one where I see whether I read my most anticipated releases of 2023. Now, something I do is I split my anticipated releases videos into two, because there's a lot of books that come out at the end of the year that aren't announced in January, or we don't have a lot of information in January. So I split them into two, and I always react to them in two, and I thought maybe I should combine them because, like, you know, then I'm like doing two videos like this, ready to do that. But then it takes me like 25 minutes, half an hour to like film these videos. So then if I combine them, it would be like an hour unless I drastically reduce what I'm saying. So I've been going back and forth, and originally I was going to do them both in this video, but now I've decided I'm just gonna react to the first half of 2023 because I don't wanna like just be like, read it, haven't read it. I wanna actually say something of worth. So we're just gonna be reacting to the most releases and most anticipated releases 2023 from January to June, and we're gonna split it into four categories. We're gonna have read and liked, read and didn't like, unread and still interested, and unread and no longer interested. And we're gonna track all those and see, do I actually read the books that I say I'm going to? Firstly, can I just say, my makeup in this video, huge slay, major slay, absolute slay.
Seriously, because, no, she's eating. She ate with that. Gobbled, cleared the plate.
I need to start doing fun eyeshadow makeup again, because I just do the same eyeshadow makeup every single day, because I literally do the same eye every single day, because I just could do it in my sleep at this point. Like, I could literally do it with my eyes closed. I like know it on muscle memory. And so it's just easy when I'm getting ready, but I need this. I know how I would do it as well. It's with one of my Natasha Denona palettes. I need to get on that. Anyways, how do I think I'm gonna do with this? I always say with these, if I've read half, that's a win. Okay, let's get into it. First is Age of Vice by Deepti Kapoor. I got sent this from Book of the Month. This is one of my choices this month. I haven't read it. I'm still interested in that one. Haven't read it, but still interested. That's quite sad that I haven't read that yet. Considering I already owned it at the time of filming this video, you know, a year and a half ago. This is one that I was hoping was going to be nominated in the Goodreads Choice Awards at the end of last year, because I would have read it then. I'm still really interested in it. It's more of like a literary thriller, and I think it's to do with like money and like Ocean's 11 kind of like money laundering. I might be wrong. That's like what I feel. I don't remember a lot about this one, but I remember people enjoying it. Age of Vice. Am I chatting out of my ass? I sometimes, guys, there's a lot of books. There's a lot of book synopses that go through my brain. And sometimes the right information stays and sometimes it doesn't, you know? Yeah, where money, pleasure, and power and everything, a family ties a bind. Yeah, so it's like a rich family. Maybe there's a bit of an underbelly of crime. Yeah, I'm really interested in that one still, but have not read it.
Then we have Highly Suspicious and Unfairly Cute by Talia Hibbert. This is Talia Hibbert's YA debut, and I'm very excited. We're following...
Okay. I have read it. I've read Highly Suspicious and Unfairly Cute. Did I put it in read and like? I gave it like a 3. I'm gonna say liked. I didn't dis... What rating did I give it? I think I gave it a 3. I think I gave it a 3. I liked it, but I didn't love it. I didn't love Talia Hibbert's writing in a YA setting. I think I would have much preferred it in an adult. And I didn't love the storyline. I'm saying like I didn't like it. It was cute, you know? It was cute. It was an easy read. It was like, they went camping. That was fun. But it was not, it doesn't, oh God, my makeup is such a slay. And this like almost makes me want the blonde hair back, but I don't. Blonde hair looked better on camera than it did in person. I suit in person my dark hair much better, but it's like, oh, look at that. I think that's like freshly done. Not freshly done, there's a bit of root there, but like fairly freshly done. And I'm like, oh, what a slay. What a slay. Anyways, sorry, I'm just getting distracted by myself.
I definitely have had a moment where I've said to myself, wow.
It was cute, but it's, I love the Brown Sister Trilogy by Talia Hibbert. I've never read, oh, I read a Christmassy novella from Talia Hibbert that was cute, but I've never read more of her like Kindle Unlimited kind of stuff. I've only read her more traditionally published stuff. It was okay.
Then we have A Million to One. I have been so excited for this one, but I need to get my hands on the US cover because the UK one is horrible.
Yeah. That's why I haven't read it, because it's one of those books that, like, how do I go about getting the US cover and can I be asked? Do you know what I mean? But also, I think this one didn't come out as early as I thought. Was it delayed publishing? Maybe not. Again, there's, like, little bits of information that float around in my brain to do with books. This is, we're talking a year and a half ago. I love the US cover. I hate the UK cover. That UK cover is so horrible. I'm so sorry. I don't like saying that because, like, someone made that. But how are the covers the same vibes, but, like, so drastically different? I don't understand. So yeah, I'm still interested. This is like set on the Titanic. It's like there's a treasure on the Titanic and all these girls. I'm not sure if they're, I think they're working together in a team to steal it. So I think they all bring different stuff to the table. I'm really, really, I still really want to read this, but I'm not reading that UK cover. I'm so sorry. Cannot bring myself to do that. So that's why I've never read it, because it's been too difficult to get my hands on. Oh, then we have This Book Kills by Ravina Garon. This is another YA book. We're not doing very well, babes. We're not doing very well. Unread and still interested. I do own this one. This one, it sounds like such a fun YA murder mystery. So she's written a perfect murder. She's like in a story or something, and someone starts doing it. It sounds so good. It sounds so good. But this is one, I don't think I've heard anyone talk about this. I don't think I've heard anyone review it. I don't know anyone's opinion on it. I do not know a single person's opinion on this. But it, you know, I feel like it could give me what, you know, Good Girl's Guide to Murder gives me. I have trouble sometimes with YA murder mysteries. Sometimes I don't love them. No one I really know has read it. Alice Oseman has read it, but didn't rate it. So.
I'm a little bit concerned.
So yeah, I still want to read it, but I'd love to know what someone else thinks of it. And I think that's why I haven't prioritized picking it up. Then we have Hellbent by Leigh Bardugo. This is the sequel to Ninth House. I loved Ninth House. I adored Ninth House. Yeah. I have read and liked Hellbent. Didn't love it as much as Ninth House, which is an unpopular opinion. My dad loved Hellbent. He was obsessed with Hellbent. But I really enjoyed it. I love the Ninth House series. I love it. I think it's my favorite Leigh Bardugo. It's my favorite flavor of Leigh Bardugo. I think it was the first, did I read Ninth House? I think Ninth House might be the first Leigh Bardugo I ever read. I love Six of Crows and Crooked Kingdom too. They're a slay as well. But I just think Ninth House is so fun. It's so fun. And I'm going to be sad if, I think we only have one more book in the series. I say this whenever we talk about Ninth House, because I just imagine a world where I had an 8 book Ninth House series and now it's only 3, and that like really upsets me. But it's just something about it. I think like the kind of this style of dark academia, this style of like, you know, set at Yale. This is Yale, right? Was it Harvard? One of those. You know, set at this school. It feels very nostalgic to me when I started reading books on BookTube. Sorry, everyone, my camera died and I had to recharge it. But what I was saying was, this style of book, it just feels very nostalgic to me. You know, I feel like this was the height of when dark academia really became popular. Obviously, it's still incredibly popular, especially around, like, spooky season. Everyone wants dark academia book recommendations. But, like, for me personally, at this time, I read a lot of them. I read The Secret Christie, I read If We Were Villains, I read Ninth House, I read Catherine House, I'm sure there was many more. So, Truly Devious, I read a lot of dark academia. I was, like, basically reading like 50% dark academia, I feel like. Then we have Things We Do to Our Friends by Heather Darwent. I think this is a debut. I have not read it. Yeah. Another one I haven't heard a ton of people talk about. It was a debut thriller. It seems like, you know, creepy. I own it, so I still do want to read it, but I don't really know anything about it. Yeah, okay. Set University of Edinburgh. Okay. Yeah, I still do want to read it, but I haven't read it. Sorry.
Then we have How to Sell a Haunted House by Grady Hendricks. This one is following two siblings.
Haven't read it. Oh my god, still interested. This is embarrassing. But I feel like in my defense, this was not the actual date it came out. Didn't it come out at the end of last year? And yet, I could be bullshitting. Or was this the date? Was this the release date after it had been delayed? I haven't read it. I feel like this is the only Grady Hendrix I haven't read. Grady Hendrix is probably my favourite horror author. I just love his flavour of horror. I have the US cover now. Erica, who came on the Costa Rica trip, got me this very kindly. So I have the US cover for it. Because again, if I had the UK cover, I wouldn't even own it, mate. I wouldn't even own this book yet.
The finer things in life. I like the finer things in life.
Oh, then we have another one of my most exciting ones. We have Mysterious Case of the Alperton Angels by Janice Hallett. Again, I spoke about this in my last video.
Yep. We have read it. We have read The Mysterious Case of the Alperton Angels and I loved it. This is my favorite Janice Hallett so far. I always say I think this is the most easily recommendable. Is that a word? Widely recommendable? Is recommendable a word? Yes, it is. The English language is escaping me all of a sudden. If you want to start Jenna's Palette, I wouldn't recommend starting with The Appeal. I would recommend this one. I think it's got a great mix of mixed media. The Appeal is just emails. The Twyford Code is just audio transcripts. Whereas this got a real variety to it. And I just loved it. I think it's a really, really solid mystery. You know, you guys know I love what Jenna's Palette does. And I've read it. Then we have God Killer by Hannah Kinnear. This is another... Oh, this is a HarperCollins. That was a crazy face. I have read it, didn't like it. I did not like God Killer. I read this for my patron book club in the end and womp womp, didn't rate it at all. I did not like this, didn't like it. I just thought this was a really disappointing fantasy. I thought that the plot didn't stand up. I thought the characters didn't stand up. There's a weird romance in it. And I would have DNF'd this had it not been for the patron book club. I did not have fun with this. And I know it's, you know, some of it, the sequel's been popular. I just thought it was really like, unfinished, not a full story. Yeah, not a fan.
Drag her, slay her, read her. Sipping on that treaty, hunty.
Then we have The Drift by CJ Tudor. This is, I think, verging on more horror for CJ Tudor. And I think we're following three different characters. There's a deadly virus happening. One of them I know is making, trying to make the vaccination.
What's not clicking?
Another one wakes up in like a snow lift in uniforms.
I've read it. I did like it. I gave it 4 stars. I was thinking, is it that one? I just couldn't remember if The Drift was the one. I've read it, right? I've read The Drift. I know I've read the book with that plot, but I'm like, yes, okay, I read it. I enjoyed this one. Obviously not enough because it was, no. I know I've read that book, but I wasn't connecting whether that was The Drift. No, this is a really fun horror book during a pandemic. And you've got three different scenarios. You're following three different storylines, but they are all really strong. I didn't mind them being kind of like split timeline because they kind of have links to one another without getting into it too much. I thought this was really, I really, really enjoyed it. I love, CJ Tudor is my 4-star horror author. I give her 4 stars every single time. Okay, we've read as many as we haven't read so far. So we're not doing too badly.
Then we have All the Dangerous Things by Stacey Willingham. In this, we are following...
Yep, we've read it. I liked it. I liked All the Dangerous Things. It was like a strong 4-star for me. I feel like Stacey Willingham is like very generic thriller, like almost crazily generic thriller. Like if you want a generic thriller, here you go. She's serving it up to you on a plate. Like,
I hate to say that, but it's true.
Like she... But I have enjoyed both of their easy reads. This is the one I believe where it's a mother whose child was stolen and she's dealing with the after effects and hasn't been able to sleep since then. And it's pretty forgettable, but I remember I really had fun reading it. You know, sometimes you need a thriller like that.
Then we have The Murder Game by Tom Hindle. Tom Hindle wrote A Fatal Crossing, which I didn't love, but I have high hopes for him.
Oh girl, you got a big storm coming. I read and hated The Murder Game. Tom Hindle, it upsets me so much because I feel like he writes some of the most exciting premises of like modern murder mystery, right? I love when I hear the sounds of his books. I love the covers. I love the aesthetic. I love what he's going for. I love that they're, you know, like given a fairly big publishing budget for a murder mystery in modern times. Like I love it. I have not really enjoyed either of his books. And everyone's like, oh, have you read Murder at Lake Garda? Don't think I'm going to be reading Tom Hindle. Unless there's a synopsis that is like beyond, I think I have to swear off Tom Hindle because this was so disappointing. I think this was more expectations versus reality. The fact that I got promised they're playing a murder mystery game, like they're playing murder mystery game, people get murdered throughout the game, and they never played the fucking game because someone got murdered and they're like, oh, can't do it. I hated what had been promised to me and how not a single element of it was livid. Not a single element of it was livid. So yeah, I did not enjoy this one.
Then we have Nobody Asked for This by Charlie Cox. I almost forgot to put this on here. So
interesting. I have not read and I'm not interested because this was a new release from Charlie Cox, who is one of my favorite poetry authors. I love She Must Be Mad and Validate Me. But this is basically an anthology of kind of both of the poetry from both of those books combined with a few new ones. And I'm just not interested in spending money on that. I'm gonna be honest with you. I didn't know at the time, I think, when I made this video, but yeah, it's basically like poetry from both of her previous books and a few little extra ones. And I'm not interested in that. That really upset me. Nobody asked for this, quite literally. No, I love Charlie Cox. I love what she does. I just think, just wait, write a few more poems and just do another book. I'm not spending like £15 on mostly poems I've already read and own, you know? I'm not doing it.
Then we have Venko by Sherry Demoline.
Ooh,
this is Witches. Okay.
This is a Witches. Unread and still interested. This one was a little bit difficult to get my hands on in the UK, but it's witchy. I know that I need to read more witchy books. Guys, all of my videos, all my vlogs the rest of the year are planned, but I feel like I haven't got enough, like, witchy books. Maybe I'll have to try and shoehorn them in somehow. I don't know. I feel like I need to get back to my roots. This is making me want to read some, like, dark academia and some witches, but I haven't got many of them planned. I feel like I'm running away from my roots. Take me back.
Yes. This is a concern and a worry.
The Last Tale of the Flower Bride by Roshani Chotsky.
Unread and still interested. I don't remember the plot of this is. I've never read Roshani Chotsky. I know she's a super popular author. What is the series? The, like, old school booktube series. Now I must know. What is that? And I've never read it. Oh, The Gilded Wolves. I own it. I own The Gilded Wolves. I remembered without having to Google. This was her adult debut. And I heard good things from people who read it. But again, I don't own it. So I'm still interested, but not high on my list.
Then we have The Villa by Rachel Hawkins. I love a bit of Rachel Hawkins. Well, I've read one. I read Reckless Girls.
Unread and still interested. I mean, some of these ones I'm saying still interested, it's like a middle of the road. Like, I'm not... If I saw it in the shop, would I prioritize buying it? I don't know if I would. But if I had the opportunity to read it, I would be excited to do so. Like this, Roshani Chotsky one. Like, I'm not like gasping, like desperate to read it, but I would still be interested. But yeah, The Villa, haven't read it. I heard mixed things about this one. This is the one where there's like a split timeline and there's like an artist in the villa like many years ago. I heard mixed things about this one.
Then we have Lost in the Moment and Found by Shauna Maguire. This is the 8th in the Wayward Children series. We're deep in.
We've read it. I've read even the next one. I'm just too good at this shit. I really enjoyed Lost in the Moment and Found. It's where we meet Antsy, who we also follow in the book after, and she's in this world where, you know, if you've read Wayward Children, you know that it's like portal fantasy. Children going into worlds are perfect for them. And she's in this kind of shop that is a nexus of other worlds, essentially. And I really enjoyed it. I really loved how, you know, the sensitivity that Shauna Maguire tackles the issues in this. I mean, if there's a Wayward Children book on the list, it's basically a free pass because I'm going to read it pretty quickly.
Then we have What Lies in the Woods by Kate Ellis Marshall. This is my first Kate Ellis Marshall I've owned. But
I just read it. I just read it for my Patreon book club. Read and liked it. Again, all I have to say about this, 4 stars, had a lot of fun reading it, instantly forgettable. And I knew that while reading it. I was like, you are so generic. There's a podcast, there's a fucking cold case, small town, everyone knows something, yada yada, you know. It is so generic. When I was reading it, it was almost nostalgic to me. I found reading it quite comforting because I was like, this is just like meeting an old friend again, but it's a new book. You know, it was like reading an old favorite book, but it's a new book because it basically is every other book you've ever read. It's so generic and so forgettable. But I think most people kind of liked it when reading it in the book club.
This is one of the big releases of the year. It's one of the most anticipated books. I've seen it on so many anticipated lists. It is I Have Some Questions For You by Rebecca Mackay.
So I've read it. This one was a tricky one. I liked it. I read this for the Goodreads Mystery Thriller Awards. And this one was like, I did not like the first half. The first half was like split timeline. I just didn't like the writing style. But the second half was a court case. And I do love me a good court setting. This is like one of my niche interests. I like watching Emily D. Baker on YouTube when she does court cases. Like when she did the Murdaugh trial and she did the Karen Reid trial. I watch that shit. So I do like a good court setting. So I really loved the second half of this, but I really did not like the first half. So it was a tale of two cities. This was like trying to be literary. I don't think it, if you're just reading it as a book, it's fine. But I don't think it really, it was trying to be intelligent. It was trying to like be an intelligent approach to true crime. Be like, oh my God, I'm so clever. I have all the answers to whether true crime is moral or not. And I really don't think it answered any of those questions it was trying to raise well. But I liked the court setting.
Last one in February is She Is a Haunting. I just know this is a YA... What do I know? It's a YA haunted house book.
Oh, I didn't know that. See, I want to say unread and still interested. Like, I'm not like... This is another one of those where I don't really know anything about it. I love the cover, you know? And if I had to read it, I'd be like, yay! Oh, woohoo! You know? But I'm not... I don't know if I'm not searching this book out anymore. I'm not like, oh, I really want to get to that book anymore. You know? I really want to buy that book anymore. But if it came, I'd be like, oh my god, yay, I'm excited to read that. So I'm going to say unwritten, still interested, but, you know, do with that information what you will.
Then we have The Unforgettable Alexandra Shaw by A. Lloyd Spanton.
See, again, I'm listening to me telling me the plot, and I'm like, sounds interesting. New information.
Interesting.
This is another 50-51. I'm going to put it in unread and not interested just to balance the scales a bit. Because if I keep putting all of these 50-51s in unread and still interested, it's not truly... So, like, both this and She Is a Haunting are, like, 50-50. And I'm representing that statistically. It's not that I'm not interested, but, like, I'm not super interested either.
Then we have The Writing Retreat. Ooh, girl.
Yes. The Writing Retreat. Read and loved it. Anyone who didn't like this, absolutely wrong. Absolutely incorrect. Absolutely has no reading taste. Like, I had so much fun reading The Writing Retreat. I thought it was ridiculous. I thought it was completely bonkers. Oh, I loved The Writing Retreat and so glad that I got to it.
Oh, then we have a non-fiction. I think this might be the only non-fiction. I don't tend to put non-fictions on my most anticipated, but this is The Once and Future Sex. This is all about women in medieval history.
Okay, unread and still interested, I do own this now. This was one I didn't get to for ages because it was so expensive. When a book is like 20 plus pounds, it was like, £22-23, I'm like, okay, that's really, it's hard for me to justify. Like,
this is my financial situation, so I'm broke.
Like, I just never get around to buying it because it's more expensive. But I had, like, an Amazon voucher, and this is what I spent it on because I'm still super intrigued by it. I think this could be a favorite nonfiction. Like, I think I could really, 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 really enjoy it. You know, it's about women in medieval times. Like, what is their... What was expected of them? How is a women's roles today and throughout history affected by medieval times? It sounds super, super interesting. So I own it and I'm super interested in it.
Oh, The Mimicking of Known Successes, I've seen a lot of people talking about, and all I'm going to tell you is that it is a sapphic murder mystery set on Jupiter.
Yeah, sapphic murder mystery set on Jupiter. That's a Sherlock Holmes retelling. Oh, I really liked this. I literally just read this like a week ago and it was so much fun. And I'm excited to get into the rest of the series. It was really, really, really fun. Really, really fun. 4-star, the murder mystery part was the weakest part of it, the plot was the weakest part of it, the strongest part was the Sherlock Holmes retelling this, the world building on Jupiter, and the romance. They were the strong parts, the murder mystery wasn't so much, but I had a lot of fun.
Then we have What Happened to Ruthie Ramirez. This is about a girl who went missing, I think, when she was about 10.
I'm gonna say unread and not interested. I don't think I'm interested in this. I haven't heard anyone read it. I think this is more literary, like it's framed as a mystery, but I think it's more fiction. And I just haven't heard anyone's opinions. I'm not interested in this one, I don't think, anymore. I think it's one of those books that's framed as a mystery, but it's more literary, and that's always disappointing.
Then we have Vera Wong's Unsolicited Advice for Murders. I've never read anything by this author. This is the author of Dal A for Aunties.
I have read and really enjoyed Vera Wong's Unsolicited Advice for Murders. Another one from the Goodreads Awards thing. Thingy-majiggy. Awards thing. But I really enjoyed this. This is like a really fun, cozy murder mystery where Vera Wong is solving a murder because she don't believe the police can do it. And she's like becoming a found family with also the people that she suspects of doing the murder. And it was just really, really fun. Really, really fun. And one of my probably like a top recommendation for me that I think you guys, that everyone could kind of enjoy.
Next we have The London Seance Society by Sarah Penner. This is by the author of The Lost Apothecary, which I really enjoyed.
Yeah, this synopsis sounds great. Okay, I really enjoyed Lost. I'm gonna say unread and still interested, but again, I'm not like chomping at the bit. It's not like one of those books. There's certain books that I don't own yet that I'm like, oh, I'm desperate to get to that, you know? Whereas, yeah, I really enjoyed Lost Apothecary. I love the idea. This would be perfect for this time of year. Seances. Oh, it sounds incredible. But yes, I don't own it. And I gave Lost Apothecary 4, and that was a debut. So I would be intrigued. And I love that kind of like Victorian obsession with seances and everything. So yeah, this is definitely up my street.
Next we have Three Drops of Blood by Gretchen McNeil. This is the author of the hashtag murder trending series.
I'm gonna say unread and not interested. I enjoyed, yeah, I just haven't heard good things about this. I think this is like YA horror. And I just think, like, if you're writing horror, just don't make it all, you know, I'm not as interested. I think it's going to pull its punches a little bit. The hashtag murder trending is kind of, like, trashy.
Well, just as I thought, trash.
Like, not great quality of writing, but it was fun, you know? I think I give it 2 stars, but, like, I was kind of like, it's kind of trash. That's, I didn't give it 2 stars. I gave it more than that. Maybe 3. Because I am continuing with the series. But I'm not. This is not a book that has entered my brain for a year, at least.
Next, we have A House with Good Bones by Tegan Fisher. I have not yet read any Tegan Fisher, but I'm excited to get into all of her flavors of her work.
That's crazy. At this point, I hadn't read any Tegan Fisher. Now I've read probably like 4, at least. Wow, I love Tegan Fisher. This is probably my favorite. I gave this 4.5 stars. It's a woman who moves back in with her mother into her grandmother's house. And her mother is starting to act like her grandmother did, like be a bit racist or like the weird shit going on. It's a weird house. The house is fucked up. Loved it, darling.
Next is Camp Zero. I just know this is a climate change-esque book.
Unread, I'm gonna say still interested, but again, it's not, you know, I don't think about her that often.
What do I think of her?
Yes.
I don't think of her.
I don't think about this book that often, but a climate change kind of thriller I think I'd be really interested in. So it's still on my radar vaguely, but again, there's a lot in common with a lot of these books.
Oh, this one's so stupid. We have Reach for the Stars by Michael Cragg.
One of my favorite books of the year, baby. I really loved it. This is a nonfiction, a spoken history about UK pop from 1996 to 2006. It's so much fun. Spice Girls, Girls Aloud, Sugar Babes.
Slowly but surely you start to realise, actually, I can't nip to the garage in my pyjamas anymore for a pint of milk, even if I want to.
Steps, Blue, Busted. Ah, it's so good. It was so fun. Like I've said many times, it's a very niche book. It's a very specific subset of my audience who would be interested in this. I think even if some of you are like, I'm American, but I loved Spice Girls. Like, Spice Girls are 2 chapters, right? The rest is like 5, or I don't know, some more niche fans. I think if you're really into the pop scene at this time, it's your era in the UK, I would 100% recommend this. I think it's amazing, but I know that's a niche subset of you.
Next is Nick Blake and the Remarkables by Andrew Thomas. This is Andrew Thomas's middle grade debut.
Another one I'm not sure if I own or not. The TBR is getting out of hand. Like, I always have a pretty good grasp on what I own, what's on my TBR, whatever, and I'm just feeling a little bit out of the loop, but I unread and still interested. This is, yeah, Angie Thomas's middle grade debut, and I've loved everything that I've read from Angie Thomas. I feel like she's like another big book to come out, you know, because Concrete Rose, because it was kind of like a prequel, didn't have that same hit that I feel like The Hate You Give and fuck, what was the rapping one called? I really enjoyed that one. Ah, see, I'm losing my book knowledge. Maybe my brain's just a bit skew-off at the moment. But yes, I really enjoyed Angie Thomas's stuff, so I'm intrigued by this one.
Then we have Untethered Sky by Fonda Lee. Ooh. I don't know much about this because it is a novella. This is her first release, I think, since the Greenbone saga. And I think it's like an animal-based...
My first instinct was unread, not interested. But it's not that I'm not interested. But again, I'm not... These ones I'm saying I'm not interested in... I'd still read them. If you're like, make a new series book, I'd be like, yay! But I have not thought of that book for a very long time. And I heard mixed things about it. I heard not the best things about the kind of like bird. I think it was just people who read it. I remember Mara didn't love it, that it was just felt a bit unfulfilled, you know, unfinished.
We have In the Lives of Puppets by TJ Klune. This is TJ Klune's new release this year.
Read it. I think I gave it 3 stars. I've got to put it under read and liked, but I was disappointed because it was TJ Klune, you know, and I expected more. I expected better. So I liked it. You know, this is a puppet. His dad gets taken away and he goes on a quest to find him. I don't want to talk about it. I liked it. It was fine, but it wasn't, you know, it wasn't what I expect from TJ Klune.
Next is Death of a Bookseller. I think this is going to be another popular book this year.
Read and did not like. We read this for the Patreon Book Club again. It's been quite a few of these for the Patreon Book Club. Did not like this one. Did not like Death of a Bookseller. This was a weird ass book and it needed to be workshopped a bit. It was a first draft. It felt like it didn't quite figure out what it wanted to say. It was trying to make true crime commentary, but also not make true crime commentary. The ending was really disappointing. None of us liked this. This is a really unpopular one for the book club.
For the First Time Again by Sylvain Nouvel, I'm just mentioning here, I have not read the synopsis of this because it is the third in a series and I've only read the first.
Still only read the first.
This is awkward.
Unread and still interested because I'm still currently reading this series, but I didn't have shit to say about that one.
Ellie Engel Saves Herself is Leah Johnson's middle grade debut.
Similar, I'm going to say unread and still interested, but this is similar to the Angie Thomas one, where it's like a middle grade debut from an author that I really enjoy, but I'm not reading much middle grade anymore, but I'm still interested because I have really enjoyed both Angie Thomas and Leah Johnson's stuff. So, moving on. I'm not reading a ton of middle grade, but I am interested.
The Chateau by Jacqueline Goldis is another thriller that's coming out. We have this grandma who's like...
Yeah. Rich grandma dies. Redden liked this. I liked this. Not a ton of people did, but I thought it was fun. I thought it was fun, ridiculous thriller. It's set in Paris, France. No, it may not be Paris, but it's France. I think it's south of France, actually.
But I did tell a bit of a lie there.
It's set in France, this massive house with this rich grandma and a girl, a granddaughter and her friends go and visit again and the grandma dies. And what's going on? It was a fun time. Would I really recommend it to you guys? Not necessarily. I think there's probably better things out there. But did I have a fun time reading it? Yes. And am I interested in what Jacqueline Goldis is doing? Because the main character, her new release, sounds really, really good, synopsis-wise. So she intrigues me.
Next is Yellowface by R.F. Kuang.
I'm doing okay. I read and loved Yellowface. I love R.F. Kuang. What a genius. I remember I went to the Yellowface talk and she's just amazing. She is just an amazing, amazing person. I don't know how she does everything that she does. I loved Yellowface. Loved it.
It's The Shadow Cabinet by Juno Dawson. I really want to get to the first one this year. So,
okay, I have at least gotten to Her Majesty's Royal Coven, but I have not read The Shadow Cabinet, but I'm still interested. I own it. I'm really excited to read Queen Bee as well, which is like a related novella that just came out.
We have Orson is Bleed by S.A. Cosby. I've never read anything by S.A. Cosby, but this one sounds really interesting.
So you have now, baby, because you read and liked it. Another one I read for the Goodreads Mystery Thriller Choice Award. I always say different combinations of words whenever I mention that. Goodreads Choice Awards Mystery Thriller, Goodreads Mystery Thriller Choice Awards, Mystery Thriller Goodreads Choice Awards. I really enjoyed this. This was a 4-star. I read this like towards the end when I was like in the trenches a little bit, like trying to get through it. But I enjoyed this. It was more of a literary thriller. I really enjoyed S.A. Cosby's writing. So I want to try out more of his stuff. Maybe Razorblade Tears, because I have heard really good things about that.
We have Never a Hero by Vanessa Lenn, which is the sequel to Only a Monster. And we have A Death in the Parish by Richard Coles, which is the sequel to Murder in Evensong.
Okay. I'm not interested in the Only a Monster sequel because I think I may have unhauled Only a Monster. It may still be here. I'm going to say not interested. That doesn't excite me seeing that. But I am still interested in Death in a Parish because I have bought that, which is a bit nervy because I haven't read the first book and I haven't heard the best things, but I wanted the dogs. There were sprayed edges with dogs and I wanted the dogs. So I got the second book.
This is like art. Like, I love it. Like, there's something about this.
We have The Last Word by Taylor Adams, another one I put on my 2023 TBR.
Read and loved it, baby. Last Word by Taylor Adams. Oh, so good. So good, so good. Read it this year. I love you, Taylor Adams. I love you. Love you, Taylor Adams. I just love what he does. He's a genius. I loved it. Last Word is so fun. Campy, ridiculous, over the top. Everything I want from a Taylor Adams book.
Then Love Theoretically by Ellie Hazelwood. I love Ellie Hazelwood. She loves me.
There's some bangers. There's some bangers on this list. Absolutely. Read and loved it. I love you, Ellie Hazelwood. Ellie Hazelwood could do no wrong. I would never give her less than a 4-star. Never. Never. Never happening. Love Theoretically is a really good one. If you're going to start with Ellie, I think start with either The Love Hypothesis or Love Theoretically. I think they're the best ones.
The last one is The Other Side of Mrs. Wood by Lucy Baker. This is about a medium, I think, within Victorian times.
Okay, this is another Victorian seancey medium book. I've read half of it because I started reading it from, so I'm going to say unread and still interested. I enjoyed the half, well, maybe not half, I think I've read like a third of it actually, because I started reading it for video and then realized I actually should not be reading that book for the video. And so I stopped it. This was like a year ago. So I've read a third of it and I really enjoyed that first third. I would say it was like a 4-star territory. So I love the cover as well. This cover is so satisfying to me. But yes, I've read a third of it and then I had to stop. Okay, everyone, that is all of my first half of 2023. Absolutely, I'm not doing this as a two-part video. Can you imagine how long this would be? Not bad. Not bad. I'd say it's around half. Not bad. And there were some bangers in there. Like Love Theoretically, The Last Word, Yellowface. Reach for the Stars, The Appleton Angels is on here. There's some great books. Lost in the Moment and Found, The Writing Retreat. Oh my God, there were some absolute bangers on this list. But yeah, let me know, out of the ones that I haven't read, which ones, my hair has gone a bit crazy, which ones I should prioritize getting to. Let me know what you thought of any of the books on this list. I think I did okay. I think that's not bad. I'm not sure how the second half, I'll do the second half maybe at the start of next year. Just because I like to give myself time to have read the books. I'll do the second half reaction at the start of next year, maybe. And we'll see how we do. But I don't know if I've done as well. But that's all right. That's all right. Anyways, thank you guys for watching. I hope this was interesting. And I'll see you very soon in another video. Bye.